as, you know, which have quite a good impact. I think he published your book also.
Yeah.
So we would be happy. In our book discussion, especially with new books, we also invite the publisher to say a few words.
Namaskar. Today, our Sridhartanji's mother met with a small accident. So she's hospitalized. I think Sridhartanji may not be able to join.
Oh, I'm very sorry for that. I'm very sorry to hear that. All right, we can proceed without him. I'm waiting for Harishankarji to show us his face. Is he online, Dr. B. S. Harishankar?
Can you hear me? He's online.
He's not answering for some reason.
I'm online.
Okay, please show us your video. Harishankarji, please show us the video. Then we will start. You can please click on your video below. If you go down, there you are. Wonderful. Yes, excellent. And you're so clear also, very, very clear, which means you have good reception. So now that the author is with us and the chief guest is also with
you are
permission,
also
friends. Oh, yes, I am the, what should I say, the facilitator today. So if we have your permission, Nandkumarji, we can.
Of course.
Okay, wonderful. So friends and fellows of the Indian Institute of Advanced Study, I'm very, very happy to welcome you to our book discussion this afternoon. And the star of the show today is Dr. B.S. Harishankar, whose book we are going to talk about. It's called Cultural Terrorism, Conflicts and Debates on Cultural Pasts. So I will just for 2 minutes announce how we want to conduct our program today. So in the beginning, I'll say a few words about Dr. Harishankar, about our chief guest, J. Nandakumarji, and also a few remarks about the book. After that, Nandakumarji will formally release the book. Whoever has a copy of the book can hold it up like this so that we have a photograph. All this is virtual, I'm afraid. Given our restrictions, we will have to do this virtually. So we will do this when I request Nandkumarji to, hold up the book. Harishankarji can also hold up the book like this. So the book will be launched formally. After that, I'll invite Nandkumarji to say a few words about the book or about whatever he wishes to highlight today. After that, I'll invite Harishankarji to give his own comments, how he came to write the book, what was his main objective, and whatever else he may want to say about the book. And then we will have a discussion on this book and on its contents. So is that all right? Shall we proceed on those lines?
Yeah.
Okay, sure. Very good. Very good, excellent. We will just wait for a minute. I guess Nandakumarji will be back with us. I don't see him there.
I'm here.
Okay, so shall we proceed?
Yes, sir.
Thank you so much. So friends, first of all, I'm very proud and honored to welcome the author of this book, Dr. B.S. Harishankar. We are fortunate to have him as a member of our academic committee. He is actually in the committee. He's very quiet. He doesn't say much. But he's a man of firm conviction and solid learning. His PhD is from the University of Pune. He's a trained archaeologist and he has worked on some very sensitive sites. Now, I will come to the context of his work in just a few minutes, but I would also like to introduce, for those who don't know him, our chief guest today, J. Nandakumarji. He is the national coordinator of the Pragya Prava. Now, what is the Pragya Prava? As the word means, as the phrase means, it is flow of knowledge. And Pragya is, of course, not just normal knowledge, it is higher knowledge, right? But it is a forum of nationalist intellectuals. Let me put it like that. And Nandakumarji has been playing a stellar role in this forum. Those of us who know him, I was actually, let me tell you an anecdote. When I met the Sar Sanghachalak ji, Dr. Mohan Rao Bhagwat ji, a few years ago, he very quietly told me, you know, Makran ji, I want you to be associated with Nandakumarji. You keep in touch with him. That's all he said. He did not say anything more. And I must say, I confess, I have not done as much as I should have. Nandakumarji, I beg your apology. I have not been in touch with you as much as I would like to. But off and on, I've tried. Off and on, I have tried. I have followed what Dr. Mohan Bhagwatji said. Now, I mentioned this because in my life, I have found that when one is introduced by people of a higher spiritual attainment, my own guru, Yogi Ram Sarath Kumar, he would introduce people. You know, when I was in his ashram, I met up a very interesting man called Dr. Anjani Kumar. What he would say is, you both in the, you know, we had a big Pradhan Mandir. He would say, you sit there and you talk. And then I would say, but Bhagwan, what should we talk about? He said, I don't know about all that. You just sit there, you get to know each other, and you just talk with each other. So my point is that when one is introduced by people of some spiritual attainment, those relationships take on a different hue and flavor. They are not normal relationships because they have no gain and loss and networking of the normal kind. And that these relationships are permanent. I mean that they actually attain their fruition at a different level. So having said that, I must also say that he's an eminent writer. He wrote a book called Hindutva Changing Times, which I read in manuscript. And it's also a very well-written book. I recommend it to those who are interested. There is a growing literature on Hindutva. In the last 5 years, I've tracked at least 25 new books. This is one of the prominent books that has come out. And more than that, let me also tell you, he's a great scholar. He has translated the works of Guruji, that is Madhav Sadashiv Goldwalkar, from he has translated them into Malayalam, if I'm not mistaken. And it's a long work of labor. It's not easy to translate. And it must have taken many, many years to do that, because the works are in Hindi, in English, and they are quite voluminous for those who have read them. He is also doing a book on the national movement and Khilafat. So Khilafat played a very big role, you know, in Kerala. We know what happened there, how many people were killed. And in fact, I'm going to speak a little bit about Kerala now, if you don't mind. You know, but just one more word about Nandakumarji. He knows many Indian languages. He has traveled all over India. And, you know, I was happy to be associated with him when he sent me to Kerala to be the keynote speaker in the Diamond Jubilee of Kesari magazine, which he was there. And I believe recently they met to commemorate Parmeshwaram ji. He's a great person. I've known him no more, but I've known Parmeshwaram ji and Didi of the Vivekananda Kendra for at least 25, 30 years. Now I will say some words about Kerala. How has God's chosen country become the killing fields? Now, this is a question for us to, you know, contemplate, to think about, but it is directly linked to our topic. Because cultural terrorism, we may ask, what is cultural terrorism? We know what terrorism is, because people come with guns, they shoot people they don't like, and there is mayhem and chaos. India has been a victim of terrorism. We understand that kind of real terrorism with bullets, with Kalashnikovs and indiscriminate killing. Our own parliament was attacked. There have been many attacks. Balakot was attacked. Akshardham was attacked, etc., etc. I mean, thousands of lives have been lost. We understand what that is. But what is cultural terrorism? Okay. I just want you to remember 2001, when 1500-year-old Bamiyan Buddhas were blown up. Holes were drilled in these statues, dynamite was put in, and many invaders who disliked the statues could not bring them down because the feat would have been too time-consuming with chisels and with mallets and with hammers or with pickaxes. All that was easily done through modern dynamite and RDX. That, for me, is an example of cultural terrorism. And mind you, it is not 500 years old. It is now not 1,000 years old. It is not 1,500 years old. It is not the burning of Nalanda, which took place in 1190s, you know. But it is very recent, okay? It is only 20 years back that this happened in our own living lifetimes. This is an example of cultural terrorism. Let me give you another slightly more, should I say, subtle example of cultural terrorism. This is where the Politburo will decide what is published, who will speak, and you know, those who do not obey will be controlled. There are many Politburos that operate in this cultural space, the intellectual space, all over the world. And if you happen not to fall in line, whether it is the party line or the politically correct line, whatever line you want to call it, you will be cancelled. Acha, system analyst ji, kuch isme problem aa rahi hai? Hamare connection mein mujhe chehre nahi dikh rahe hain. System analyst ji, please bataiye ke network theek hai, aap logon ko sunai de raha hai?
Yes, it's...
Yes, sir, we can hear you.
Sir, network to theek hai, sir. Okay, sir, hamari taraf se.
Thank you, sir. Sorry, जैसे हम कहते हैं रुकावट एक ही है, लेकिन मैं ये कहना चाह रहा था कि यहाँ पे कई पॉलिट ब्यूरो चलते हैं, और अगर उनको आप जो कह रहे हैं, जो लिख रहे हैं, जो सोच रहे हैं, उनको यदि वो पसंद नहीं है, आप उनके चुनिंदा नुमाइंदे नहीं है, तो आपको कैंसिल किया जाएगा, है ना? So that is also a form of cultural terrorism. Now, I myself have been cancelled many times. I have lived and worked in JNU. I have faced this. I have not been allowed to go to my office. I have not been allowed to teach. I have taught under trees. I have taught in canteens. And even now, I'll tell you, I have written a book which has been cancelled. I won't talk much about myself, but I'm still facing all kinds of cancellation. And the interesting thing is, I believe myself to be an extremely open-minded person, very liberal. You know, in our institute, all kinds of opinions, all kinds of ideologies are encouraged. But we don't want any bullying, no muscle power to silence voices we don't understand. All voices should be allowed space, debate, dissent, and healthy disagreement with facts. Okay? This is our culture. And those who don't like this culture want to impose a monoculture. Only one voice, only one ideology, only one opinion. And if you don't like it, they will bully you and cancel you. So Harishankar ji has actually stood up to stepping my limits as a host. But I believe that a person like him, it is very difficult for him to get a job in the state he lives in, because the systems in place are so intolerant that even to get a job is difficult. So this is the world we live in. This is our own India. It is not some foreign country. And this is what cultural terrorism may mean. Okay. With these words, I encourage you to look at this book. I have read not all of it, I must confess. It is highly readable. And I must say the book is mild. Okay. My introduction has been a little more polemical. The book is full of facts. And it's a very widely referenced book. Please see the extent of the referencing. Okay, so many books have been read, so many articles have been referenced, and most opinions, most comments in the book have been backed up by evidence. Okay, this is what I can say as a fellow scholar, like all of you. And it shows Harishankar ji is very clued in to all the debates. And I found the book refreshing. You know, I'm deeply interested in the work of Swami Vivekananda. And when I read this book, I found that there were things I had not noticed, how Swami Vivekananda had spoken long ago about against the race theory. Okay, I mean, now we know through DNA evidence that upper caste, lower caste, North Indians, South Indians do not have a wide variation when it comes to our DNA. Okay, but Vivekananda didn't have that. He already said it. And he also wrote and spoke against the Aryan invasion theory long ago, long ago. Hari Shankarji talked about it in this book. You know, I have not, I somehow missed it. I wrote a book on Swamiji. I did not pick up some of these points there in this book. Now I will invite Nand Kumar ji to kindly release the book. Those who have a copy, please hold up the book like this so that we can get a couple of photographs. And then Nand Kumar ji will say a few words about the book. So I want to congratulate Dr. B.S. Harishankar for publishing this book. I believe it's his 9th book. He has published 8 books already. Nand Kumar ji, do you have a book? Sir, do you have a book?
Yes, I have it. But thing is that I was there in Kerala. I haven't reached to my room yet. So sorry, that book is in my room. I immediately joined the meeting.
Oh my goodness. Sorry to put you through.
I was in Kerala with Harishankar ji.
No problem. In fact, I'm grateful that you joined, though you haven't even reached your room. Harishankar ji, please hold up the book. Yeah, please hold up the book like this so that we have a photograph taken. And this is like a virtual release of the book, please. And then Nand Kumar ji will say a few words, or as long as he likes. Harishankar ji?
Yeah.
Show us.
I'm holding it.
No, but we can't see you. We are not able to see you at all.
Where is Harishankar ji?
He is audible but not visible.
Please raise the book.
Good. Please hold up the book so that the book is seen and you are also seen. Share the screen with your own book. Maybe you have to move back a little bit. If you kindly move back, Harishankar ji. That is maybe better.
Maybe because his mobile is in a vertical position, not in a landscape format. That's why.
You know, these are the joys and the challenges of virtual launches. But anyhow, please accept our heartiest congratulations, Harishankar ji. We wish you many, many more fruitful books in the future. And now I will invite, I will mute my mic and I will invite Nand Kumar ji to please say some words about this book.
Thank you, everybody. Most respected director in the Institute of Advanced Studies, Professor Makarand Paranjpai ji. And actually the person of this program, my younger brother, and also a colleague for a long period of time, Dr. Harishankar ji, the author of this beautiful book, well-researched, well-documented book, and all other most distinguished guests, academicians, my pranams to you all. At the outset itself, I beg my pardon because already it has been fixed that I have to release the online release this book, but unfortunately I couldn't reach to my place. Already the book was with me. Harishankar ji gave it me a copy much earlier, but somehow because of the problem of my travel I couldn't reach my place. So in the beginning itself, I beg all of you my pardon, and I'm announcing with all your permission that the book has been released. Okay. The very moment when I saw the title of the book, the word cultural terrorism invoked a few names like Antonio Gramsci, cultural studies, and new left, etc. to my mind. The approach of Gramsci has been identified as simply seizing the culture. Seizing the culture, I say. For us, the terminology and theory first made its appearance in a public debate during Mahishasur Jayanti celebrations on JNU campus and other prominent central universities and higher education centers. I would like to mention about my state. Already the state has been mentioned by our honorable director, Professor Makranji. Kerala, the home state of the author and mine too. Okay. In India, in our nation, Gramsci made his entry to the intellectual debates through Kerala, I would like to say, through Kerala and through Malayalam language. Perhaps Malayalam was the first Indian language in which a book about Gramsci made its first appearance. Almost the same time when Gramsci was first translated into English in 1970s, the first translation of Gramsci into an Indian language also happened in Malayalam. It is not a mere coincidence, I would like to say. It's not a mere coincidence. Decades before they launched the cultural terrorism movements on Indian campuses, like projecting Mahishasur against Durga Devi, they successfully experimented it in Kerala through the curriculum. Curriculum, I'd like to say, not only the higher education curriculum, even to the pre-primary level, they have introduced this cultural terrorism in Kerala. I would like to mention a point, an example. It is very much related to today's topic. They have successfully implemented their theory in Kerala by replacing Vamanavatara with Mahabali through school education. You all may be very well aware about one national festival of Kerala, Onam. Onam is all about Vamana Avatara of Mahabali. But in Kerala, this cultural terrorist replaced the Vamana Avatara of Mahavishnu with the Asura King Mahabali, that too through school education. Through textbooks, they popularized the warped myth that Hindus in Kerala celebrate Onam to welcome the Asura King Mahabali. In fact, according to the real legend, Kerala Hindus celebrate Onam to mark the birth of Vamanavatara. All the rituals associated with Onam are in devotion to Vamana, but its real spirit has now been deleted from public memory, and even those pujas dedicated, all the functions dedicated to Vamana and Mahavishnu are now ascribed to Mahabali. This is how cultural terrorism works, and this is what it can do to delink yourself from your cultural roots, cultural base and fundamentals. What I said is a classic example for cultural cleansing, cultural elimination or cultural annihilation is launched in Indian academics and intellectual space by cultural terrorists who are largely the left liberal lobby using ideology as a vehicle, academicians and writers as wheels, and media as fuel. We ought to be alarmed. In this context, the current book titled Cultural Terrorism, Conflicts and Debates on Cultural Past by Dr. B.S. Harishankar has much importance and relevance, especially when communist China has cracked down identities of Buddhists, Christians, and Uyghur Muslims, and Pakistan, Afghanistan, and Bangladesh have crushed the Buddhist Hindu, Sikh and Christian societies. The communists adopt the Chinese model of cultural cleansing when they capture the absolute power. They follow the great Kerala model. They follow the Kerala. This is the 11th which I have mentioned, and I give an example. Classic example of cultural cleansing or cultural tourism of Kerala. They follow this model as long as democracy exists. If we fail to counter this cultural cleansing at its very origin, it will devastate generations and eventually the idea of nation, which is rooted in our cultural and civilizational values, will be at stake. When we talk about the content of the book, I don't want to go much deep into all the aspects of the book, book which has been mentioned clearly, detailed clearly by the author, but still I just mention some points before you all. There are 21 chapters arranged in 4 sections with well-researched data. In the first section, the definition, scope and context of cultural tourism is discussed. Beijing has cracked down on Buddhist, Christians and Uyghur Muslims, which I have mentioned earlier. South Asia, especially Pakistan, Afghanistan and Bangladesh, has remained a fertile ground for ethnic cleansing by cultural tourists, largely due to dominant religio-political ideology in these countries, which has tremendously escalated since last 2 decades. Out of 428 Hindu minority places of worship in Pakistan, 408 have been converted into toy centers, toy stores, restaurants, government offices and schools in March 2001. That incident has already been mentioned by respected professor. Taliban militants in Afghanistan blew up two 1,500-year-old Bamiyan Buddha statues in defiance with international appeals. Nearly 70 historical Sikh gurudwars has been destroyed and looted in Afghanistan by Taliban. The most recent is the Kabul Gurudwara attack. Numerous Christian churches in Quetta, Lahore, Peshawar, Zangla Hill, Gojra, Mardan, Yuhanabad and Multan were attacked and burned down in Pakistan. This section highlights how a trend has recently emerged in Bharat to consistently emphasize the theory of multiculturalism in our cultural, social and political consciousness by first censoring and then expunging our idea of unity and integration. Any discussion on Indian nationalism that has also been mentioned briefly by our honorable director. Any discussion on Indian nationalism, its fundamental unity, diversity and inclusiveness is interpreted as imposing nationalism, cultural fascism and majoritarianism. Such books are being censored. You will be cancelled if you are talking about Bharat nationalism. You will be cancelled. Your book will be banned. No one will discuss about your book, your speech. Even your name will become a taboo in the intellectual circle. That is the condition which we are all facing. It has been mentioned by Director Professor Sir. In this context, the author discusses how at the start of the week-long 19th Party Congress on October 2017, President Xi Jinping signaled to party members that one can be a proud Marxist and proud of China's traditional culture at the same time. See how Chinese Communist Party is seeing about or handling their cultural fundamentals. They are saying one can become a proud Marxist and also proud of China's traditional culture at the same time. See what is happening here in Bharat. If you are talking something great about Swami Vivekananda, if you are talking something great about the Vedic culture and our civilization, immediately you will become a fascist. You will become a communalist. And if I am taking a clue out of social media, you will become a Sanghi. you'll become a Sangeet. That is a strange situation which is prevailing in our cultural area. The author discusses Russian philosopher Peter Struve, who viewed a nation, I quote, as a spiritual whole, while Nicolas Bourdieu perceived a nation as a mystical organism, a mystical personality, an eternally living subject of the historical process. Hence, Eastern nationalism is entirely different from Western nationalism, which emerged 200 years back. There, the nationalist concept itself was emerged only 200 years back. But our national concept is way, way, way back, right from Veda or pre-Vedic period, I would like to say. The author also highlights how our intellectual consciousness has been influenced by a Euro-American tradition. It denies to examine Indian influence on the Mediterranean region. Revered APJ Abdul Kalam, on 24 April 2007, while addressing European Parliament at Strasbourg, Germany, on Indo-European Union missions, which will reinforce further our strategic partnership, asked the audience to draw inspiration from Maharishi Patanjali, who lived 2,500 years ago. Recently, India's role in transmission of knowledge from East to West has been highlighted and discussed by scientists and scholars such as George G. Varghese Joseph, Paul Ernst, and Keith Delvin, who highlights the importance of Indian mathematics on the Western world. The author has well discussed these issues. You have to go through it. Thorough study, research, and references has been given. And also, in a readable style of writing. I know Harishankar for the last, 3 or 3.5 decades. I was very much close to him. Though he will not talk much in public, but he used to discuss, he used to research everything thoroughly, and he will put it very succinctly before us. The author argues that 900 years after the Crusades, when papacy apologizes to Jewish and Islamic world for the massacre and destruction, Bharat has no such apologies. Take it from me. Bharat, it is not necessary. There has not been that type of crimes and sins has been done by Bharat. So Bharat has no such apologies. It has a tradition which was inclusive, which is still emphasized by global Jewish community who lived here for more than a millennium. The Ahmadiyya Muslims are also grateful to India for the inclusive attitude shown both by Hindus despite strong opposition by Orthodox Muslims. The second part of the book, that's also very much interesting part, discusses this deconstructs colonial constructs of Aryan invasion and post-colonial constructs of Aryan migration by left historians using extensive archaeological data. The importance of Saraswati River in Indian civilizational context is discussed with emphasis on certain recently excavated site of Ragigadi in Haryana. The polluted caste system in contemporary India, which is a product of colonialism and its censors, are conveniently covered up by secessionist academicians, and instead Dalit issues are highlighted as ramification of a 5 millennium old Indian tradition brought by Aryans, empowered by Manu, and sustained by the post-Vedic legacy, as argued by the author who unmasks such age-old claims using recent studies. So, very much interesting and very much revealing facts. And also he has unmasked so many of the so-called pundits, so-called Indologists in his third section. He has contemplatively discussed issues on Indian epics, drawing our attention on left attempts as by Sheldon Pollock, Michael Witzel, and Wendy Doniger. to attack the Ramayana Mahabharata traditions. He highlights their importance in India's sacred geography, second urbanization, and in preserving our fundamental unity and diversity. These issues of such importance in colonial and post-colonial context, since Indian left, urban Naxals, NGOs, and anarchists always argue for racist identities and dubious claims, whether in Aryan invasion context, Dalit attacks, and Dravidian geolinguistic secessionism. All these factors has been brilliantly discussed in this third section. I would like to conclude. I don't want to take much time. I'm coming to the last and fourth section of this wonderfully written book. He presents extensive data to counter left Dravidian racial linguistic lobbies who are claiming a separate religio-political identity for Tamil Nadu and Kerala associated with the Western Mediterranean tradition. For raising these dubious claims, they are funded and supported by left billionaire George Soros and foreign universities for Pattanam. Pattanam is a place where in which an archaeological excavation was has come conducted, and group of this cultural terrorists are trying to establish that Kerala has got a Romo-Griso culture. For that purpose, this George Soros has also funded. And numerous evidences are put forward by the author, including international collaborations between Indian Marxists and church organizations for archaeological excavations. Author Dr. Harishankar has done an excellent job by meticulously articulating with extensive data, a reference and index. Actually, it is an important area about which more such original books and researches should be done. I would like to congratulate my younger brother Harishankar to show the guts, to dare to come out with this beautifully and revealing book. But we need lot of such researches, lot of such books come out in this count. Unfortunately, only a very few researchers like Harishankar are actively engaged in such topics. Again, I would like to congratulate Harishankar. And also I must congratulate the publisher Indus Scrolls Press, New Delhi, for bringing out the book in outstanding production quality. And also I offer my pranams, and also I am congratulating the highly esteemed institution like Indian Institute of Advanced Studies and its honorable director to conduct a discussion on this book, this wonderfully written book, rarest among the rare. Such a kind of book has been discussed before this respected, most highly educated academicians. And so I am congratulating this great institute also. And again, with these words, I am requesting all respected academicians and distinguished guests to permit me, formally, permit me to release this book, The Cultural Terrorism, Conflicts and Debates on Cultural Past, written by Dr. B.S. Harishankar. Namaskar, Vande Mataram.
Thank you, Nandakumarji. That was wonderfully expressed, very hard-hitting and inspiring. In fact, when you were talking about George Soros, I happened to open that chapter 15. And, yes. You know, he's very much in the news now with his Open Society initiative and university. And it's an over $1 billion fund. And Harishankarji talks about how in 2015, Soros's grants, his grants were banned in Russia, you know, and, you know, since then, he has talked about here in this book, how if you want to do any destabilizing research in India, which will pit communities against each other or emphasize divisiveness in society, you can apply for and get a grant from this Soros fund over $1 billion. Now, I brought this up because There's a very interesting book by a former RAW chief, Vikram Sood, called The Never Ending Game. Please read it. You know, the reason I'm saying this is because many people in academics do not know that there are, you know, should I say, not just, you know, snakes and ladders, you know, in academic work, but smoke and mirrors, you know. Behind the scenes, there are hidden manipulators who are promoting certain narratives. And the wars that we fight, as I said at the beginning, are not just with guns and bullets, but with words and ideas. And you have to see who benefits. Now, you know, who benefits if there is a very weak India with a very weak regime? Okay. Obviously, a number of forces will benefit, not just more powerful or less powerful, hostile neighbors, but also powerful multinational corporations, big data, and eventually your sovereignty is going to be compromised. There will be a new form of colonialism. Now, you know, you look at things like the new OTT guidelines. The question is, are tech giants going to control, you know, what appears true, false, or not so true, you know, the kinds of narratives on social media? I'm on social media a little bit, you know, and I know what goes on. Half of the stuff is false from all sides of the spectrum. Please don't think I'm being partisan. And, you know, this can cause tremendous mental stress. False narratives on Twitter or WhatsApp can disturb people. They can even foment disturbances and riots. And the moment you have even simple regulations or accountability, then there's a huge lobby which will immediately get mobilized, and they will say, look, India is no longer a democracy. Okay, why? Because these companies, they're not here, please let's understand, they're not here to champion freedom of expression. They're here to make money. The biggest market in the world for some of these companies is India, because in China, there's no Google, there's no Twitter, there's no Facebook, there's no WhatsApp, there's no YouTube. So India is the second most populous country in the world. And if some of these giant tech companies have Indian origin CEOs, it's not an accident. So please, as academics, we should be critical. We should open our minds and we should look at these matters with a dispassionate view. How is it that climate activists don't talk about stubble burning? You know, I have a home in Bengaluru. The lakes in Bengaluru are burning. I'm not kidding. They are foaming and burning because of chemical pollutants. And there are no activists holding up placards near the lake and trying to target stubble burning. Instead, they are going to target something else. So we have to keep our minds and eyes and ears open and understand that narrative wars are also being fought on all kinds of fault lines across the world. And there are forces which are not evident, which are at work. And I once again congratulate Harishankar ji for daring to name a few names. And also, it's not just standing on the soapbox and making a rant, okay? It is actually showing with carefully assembled evidence and references some of the topics, the so-called burning topics of the day. So thank you once again, Nandakumarji. Now I will invite Harishankarji to talk about his own book and his own intellectual journey, because as I said, to quote Mao, let a thousand flowers bloom, okay? But of course, in Mao's China, thousand flowers did not bloom because anybody who opposed him simply disappeared. You know, I have visited China 8 times and I have many friends there. And in a cafe or in someone's home, people will open up. But I challenge you, let any activist go to Tiananmen Square and hold up a placard. You know, let us see what happens there. Once you do that in China, then I will also salute the democracy in the fatherland or whatever, if Russia is not the fatherland anymore. By the way, Gorbachev is 90 years old, okay? So we must wish him, because he has perestroika, glasnost, etc. And he has survived, you know, so many decades behind the Iron Curtain and then the dismantling of all of that. and the bamboo curtain, you know. I mean, please read the documents of the Chinese Communist Party. It looks like your people are living in a fantasy land, you know, because the ideology says something and it's capitalism created by the state. Anyhow, this I is, you know, time belongs to Harishankarji, whose face we cannot see, but I'm sure his voice will be heard. Harishankarji, talk about your book, if you don't mind, and your own intellectual journey. And then we'll have a
Thank you.
Q&A.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm much grateful for our dear director, Professor Makarand Paranjape, for arranging this program, the program of my book release, despite his work in the Institute of Advanced Studies, Shimla. I thank him once again for giving a wonderful introduction regarding the book. And Sri Nanda Kumar ji, who is also the national coordinator of Prajna Pravar, he has given the complete abstract of the book within the short time. What I have to say has been given, has been presented by both Nanda Kumar ji and Professor Makarand Paranjabe ji. In fact, the term cultural terrorism came to my mind when UNESCO director Irina Bokova, she coined this term cultural terrorism regarding ethnic cleansing and also cultural eradication, rooting out of our identities for transplanting and growing up new identities based on new ideologies. So it was from the UNESCO director's usage of the term that I first came to understand what is cultural terrorism. That's a new type of terrorism. It was based on our a very vast intellectual canvas. It has a very vast intellectual canvas. It penetrates our research institutions. It encroaches our research institution. It brings out new books and publications. And this working, which is going on for in India since the last two decades, became very clear when excavation was going on in at Kediyadi in Tamil Nadu. The entire excavation was managed and it was taken up by international arms dealers, I should say here. Very precisely, I should say, it was George Soros, Father George Soros, Father Gaspar Raj, Father Gaspar Raj, who took up the excavations at Kediyadi. Gaspar Raj, he has been named by the Federal Bureau of Investigation in America as an international arms dealer for the LTT. But what is his role in the excavations going on at Kediyadi? And Kediyadi was getting connected with the Rakhi Gadi from Aryan migration, massacre of Aryans, I mean Dravidians, the Dravidians migrating to Tamil Nadu, getting settled in Kediyadi, and the Aryans occupying Rakhi Gadi. So this was here that I came to use the term cultural terrorism. International arms dealers entering our universities, research institutions, and managing our complete interpretation of the past. So from the UNESCO director, I mean UN director's Bokova's interpretation of the term, coining of the term, her narrative regarding what is cultural terrorism, I picked up the introduction for this book. Some ministers there who were discussing, like Edward said, who were discussing on this ongoing new cultural terrorism. It is based on two ideologies. One, neo-colonialism, which is backed by a Euro-American tradition, a neo-colonialism. Second, it is being funded and backed by the left ideological groups in India and and Professor Makarand Paranjabe himself has been persecuted in JNU. We know very well. And because he is a gentleman, he is not discussing much about it in a platform or Institute of Advanced Studies in Shimla. We know him since the last 2 years. He's an extremely what should I say, transparent gentleman. That's why he's not discussing publicly in academic forum. That's not good for him. This was how I came to write this book. It is not based on one topic. It is based on different topics, such as the issue of Aryan, from how it shifted from Aryan invasion to Aryan migration, the Aryan settlement, then this new Dravidian linguistic racialism that is emerging in certain parts of Tamil Nadu and certain parts of Kerala, how it's leading to in the southern tip of the peninsula, the Saraswati problem issue, how scholars have intervened and taken up the issue since the last 20 to 30 years, and how it's being taken abroad for to establish that there has been a migration. If there is no invasion, we have to establish a migration. We cannot take it out. This is the problem. Taken, it's regarding the what Nanda Kumarji has discussed on the Kijadi issue, where international arms dealers have interfered. Gaspar Raj, Father Gaspar Raj and George Soros, they have interfered at Kijadi and Patanam, connecting the two sides with Rakhigadi. But now the attempt has failed. Since Kijadi has been exposed because it is being funded by LTTE arms dealers. The Federal Bureau of Investigation reports have clearly named how Gaspar Raj is involved in arms deal and how is now he is involving in Kijadi excavations. And the fourth and the final part of this book, it's regarding how Chinese Communist Party is in the, it is encroaching various cultural institutions, universities and research institutions, both in America and Europe. And they are thwarted. Institutions in America and Europe, they are facing it, how they encroach their institutions and brainwash the students against the state and culture. And they are being funded by Gulf radical Islamic groups. So this is the summary of the book. It is not on one issue, it is on different issues. It is not against a religion, particular religion. It is neither against the Christianity or Islam, but it's against how Christianity has been uprooted from Pakistan. How the Ahmadiyyas and Shias, they are uprooted from Pakistan and Bangladesh. How the Sikhs and Hindus and Buddhists, they are facing a threat of survival in various parts of South Asia. So don't think it's based on an attack against a particular community, an attack against a particular ideology. It's against our respected professor Makarinda Paranjab has said, it's a new ideology that has emerged since the last two decades. That is cultural terrorism. It's not 500 years old. It's not 100 years old. It's a new ideology that has developed since the last two decades. So within my limitations, within my limited knowledge, I have written the book. And I thank Nanda Kumarji very much for and to release the book. My association with him is not for 3.5 decades, it's for 4 decades. It's for 4 decades. And I should thank our administrative officer, Ritika Sharma. She has taken much pains in organizing this program. She has been in constant touch with me since the last few weeks for arranging the program. And I thank all the respected scholars who have assembled here in the release function of the book. I thank everybody once again for coming to attend the program and blessing the function. Thank you. Thank you very much again once more.
Thank you. Thank you, Harishankarji. I would also like to emphasize that this book is not about any religion or any community, but it is about how ideologies invade, okay, and manipulate, think. For example, we've spoken a bit about George Soros. He's himself of Jewish descent, okay? He belongs to a Jewish Hungarian family, if you read up about him. And many people who follow some of these ideologies are so-called Hindus only. So this I must clarify, it is not against any religion or community. But let us just think for 2 minutes before I throw it open. about you know, Kerala itself and about Antonio Gramsci. This was something new I learned from Nandakumarji, that Gramsci was introduced in Kerala at the same time that he was introduced in English. Actually, I have read the prison notebooks, and selections started appearing in the 70s in English. The complete works were published, I think, by Columbia University Press quite recently. But I think Gramsci is fascinating. He's worth reading. His concept of hegemony has got worldwide currency. And in a way, it is about hegemony. How do you attain hegemony? You know, there is coercion and consent. So manufacturing consent is easy, or easier than coercing everybody. It's very fashionable to quote Gramsci, but people don't understand Gramsci fully, because everyone talks about organic intellectuals. But actually, in Gramsci, it is the party intellectuals who will lead the revolution, okay? Not the organic or the traditional intellectuals he despises. They include the clergy and, you know, the members of the aristocracy and the professoriate. We are the professoriate, okay? Organic intellectuals are those who are thrown up by the people, but it is the party intellectuals. And the reason I'm bringing up all this is because I think, and Nandakumarji and Harishankarji can correct me, Kerala is the laboratory of this ideological struggle in India, right from the time when the state was founded, and the fight between the so-called fascists and communists was imported to the state of Kerala from Europe. The contexts are totally different. In fact, I can give you the reference where Prakash Karat himself says that RSS is not fascist. Don't make that mistake of superimposing European history and its trajectory onto India. But somehow, this fight unto death, you see, and the northern Kerala, it has started, you know, in Kasaragod, and those, and I think more than 500 people have died in this fight back and forth. And somebody mentioned JNU. When I was in JNU, I asked a very innocent question. I said, Sujit was murdered. Why is there no rally against Sujit? A murder against Sujit's murder, you know. So these questions which I asked in JNU proved to be very, very uncomfortable to a number of people. Anyhow, with those words, I'm opening up this forum. So please ask or give your comments to, you know, Harishankarji or Nandakumarji. Go ahead. I'm looking at my chat box. No questions as yet. But I'm sure people will ask questions. I think our fellows will not be either floored or silent so easily. So I'm sure, please ask whatever question you have, please go ahead and ask. Or Hindi mein bhi aap pooch sakte hain. Bhasha ko leke koi pabandi nahi hai yahan. So till we get some questions, I will ask the first question to Harishankarji. How many years did you take to write this book? And were some of these, you know, chapters already published previously in, you know, like in newspaper columns or in journals or something?
Sir, this some of the articles were published in a Vijayvani column, in a blog.
Yes, yes, Sandhya Jain. Sandhya Jain. Yeah, yeah, you mentioned that. You mentioned that in your acknowledgements. Yeah. In fact, really, the acknowledgement page appears in two places, page 231.
Yeah, yeah.
And again, it appears at the very end of the book. So this is something that you can mention, Sridhar Ji. Yeah, 256. You know, the acknowledgement page appears almost twice, so that shows you are doubly grateful. But anyhow, so Sandhya Jain ji, in fact, I was going to invite Sandhya Jain also to join us. She's also somebody I've known. She and her sister Meenakshi Jain, strong and brave ladies. We should have invited Sandhya ji also. So Vijayvani published some of the columns, yes. But how many years did you take to write the book?
And Sanghyaji gave me all support for writing these columns, not all columns, but many of the columns. And then many comments were coming from the readers that I should enlarge this columns and make it more. It should be updated. So it took nearly 6 months for me to update these articles to make it more and give it to Sri Ratanji of India. He much gratefully, yes. he gratefully acknowledged that he helped me publish the book.
Indeed. When you, I'm still waiting for questions. You know, once again, refer to the idea of cultural annihilation. You know, many cultures have been completely extirpated. The yeah. cultures of the Native Americans, Australian Aboriginals, as well as the native cultures of South America. In fact, some of these annihilations are, of course, documented, but only when you visit, you really see the extent of it. For example, in South America, hardly any language of the Aboriginals has a wide currency, except one or two. The Quechua language, for example, is still there. But the dominant languages of South America are, of course, Spanish and Portuguese in Brazil. So when the language goes, the entire culture becomes downgraded. The languages of the Native Americans are also almost finished. You know, the Inuits, the Apaches, the Comanches, you know, all these great, communities that we hear of only in the Westerns. As a student of literature, I started reading these so-called blue stocking novels of Cooper, James Fenimore Cooper. And, you know, the Indian presence in the American imagination in the beginning of the 19th century was immense. And in the 21st century, it's absent. Where do you see them? And you have these revisionist Westerns now, okay, where you see different images and portrayals of that period. But cultural annihilation happened all over the so-called Middle East and Levant. And in countries such as Egypt and Pakistan, it is going on as we speak. You know, the churches in Egypt is the home of the Coptics, okay, the Greek Orthodox, and their population now is very, very low. So, countries which were half Christian, 95% Christian, you go to the main museum in Egypt and you see how the culture transited. And, all the churches have armed guards, and every now and then a church will be attacked. So cultural annihilation, cultural extermination is an ongoing phenomenon, and all kinds of weapons are used in this process. It should not be taken lightly. In India, there's been a pushback, and that pushback is what has alarmed people and have raised their heckles. And that's why we are in a state of an uncivil war, as I call it, I think critical, intelligent people must look at the evidence and not simply jump in and take sides. Okay, we have one question here from Professor Dataram Purohit, who is himself a scholar and collector, I would say, as also scholar of folklore, Himalayan folklore. He comes from the state of Uttarakhand. And Professor Purohit is asking, cultural terrorism inflicted just because we don't have the convincing counter strategies. What strategies do you suggest, sir? So I will ask both Harishankar ji as well as Nandakumar ji to respond to this question.
Harishankar ji, you please answer first of all.
In fact, terrorism, it has one destination: to create a sense of cultural schizophrenia. To create a sense of cultural schizophrenia. That's what they aim at. That's why they have penetrated, encroached major research institutions and universities. They know how to regroup and come together on sensitive issues and to spread it wide among the academic community and to create an opinion. We have to counter it. We have to counter it using substantial data. Every now and then, we have to counter it. We have to bring out more publications. It should not result, it should not get confined to one book. More books should come out. There should be frequent discussions.
Nandakumarji, would you like to say something?
The same thing which has said Shankarji has
maybe
already
we are
said.
Losing his audio. Or can you hear me? Can you hear me? Okay. Please, Nandakumarji, please, you can add to that. I'll also say a word about it in a moment.
Sorry, sir. Harishankarji hasn't concluded. He was speaking something more. I think so. Is it not?
I concluded. Okay. I concluded.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
I beg your pardon. I'm sorry if I interrupted you, Harishankarji. Go ahead.
No. You didn't interrupt me, sir. You didn't interrupt me.
Yeah. I have done the time. I have interrupted both of you. Okay.
No.
So I think as a punishment, sir, you have to speak now.
Punishment. Sir, you have asked a pertinent question, very clear question, directed question, that how we can counter it. Harishankarji has answered it clearly. As academicians, as professors, as thinkers, it's our duty to be alert, first of all. What all are going on in and around us. See, when someone is celebrating Mahishasura beyond Durga, I'm not talking anything about religion, but when someone is trying to reinterpret the whole story and an adharmic, immoral or amoral, I would like to say, personalities above the morality and our fundamental values, we have to be very alert and we have to come out with the thorough studies that what is needed to our society, just not to counter just, but to give a way, give correct view to the coming generation, the growing generation. That's one thing. And we have to be very vocal, sir. See, the main problem of our nation first thinkers are we are very much silent. So let it happen. What is the problem? They are speaking. Actually, truth is something different. So we have to be contented with our own truth, our Ramayana, our Mahabharata, our cultural moorings, our values. What is all these debates are useless. These type of thinking are also there. See, the number wise, if you are looking into the number, the cultural terrorist number are less. Take it from me. It is very less. The nation first thinkers and the people who are thinking in this line are more. Very huge number is there, but we are silent. So because of these noises, useless noises which has been created by them, people are thinking that they are more in number and this narrative is more authentic. Poor people are thinking so. So we have to come out and we also play a role in this great exercise, individually and in a group also, societally also, we have to come out with a real positive narrative. When society starts thinking in this line, of course, any government or governmental bodies will come out and they will make curriculum, and through the curriculum also, the all sort of these type of attacks and these cultural activities can be stopped. I would congratulate Harishankarji and his team during the Patanam excavation. Harishankarji may not talk about it. That's why I am talking. When Patanam excavation took place, some particular group, this term I am again using, this cultural terrorist, they came out and they manipulate the results and the so-called conclusions, and they made a narrative that Kerala was inhabited by a separate culture, a Greco-Roman culture was inhabiting in Kerala, and all other societies came afterwards only. Hindus came from north and south, they all came, and before that Greco-Romans were there. That was the way in which they tried to establish. But daringly and with all courage, Harishankar ji and his team came out. And I think 4 books were published immediately about the culture of Kerala, about the civilizational things of Kerala, and how baseless are their arguments. So in that way, they were stopped. And that activity, before the public also, it has been very well established by them. In this way, Kidadi thing also, archaeologists and also the under the direction, with the direction of Harishankar ji and all, the Kidadi excavation points and results and conclusions and observations are properly placed before the public, before these people were able to manipulate it. So in this way, we have to be very alert. We have to be a bit more vocal. We have to come out with the proper conclusions, writings. One Harishankar ji, one Professor Makaran ji is not sufficient. We all should come forward. That is only way to counter this. Namaskar.
Thank you. That's very well put. You know, I just want to add 2 words here. You know, this Mahishasur was celebrated in JNU. And we, you know, JNU, we are very liberal. We talk about things. My student said, sir, what's wrong? Why can't we celebrate Mahishasur? And then they brought me some articles, as always, students to read. So they said, look, this is a community in Jharkhand or in some place where they consider themselves the descendants of Mahishasur. So why can't they celebrate? I said, yeah, that's fine. But please don't call Durga sex worker, okay? And, this is how the debate took a turn. I said, okay. Then one person also said, what's wrong, sir? Sex workers have a lot of dignity. I said, okay, wonderful. Suppose someone called your own mother or sister one, or you yourself one, how would you react? Everybody was quiet. So you see this duplicity, this hypocrisy. I want to add one more thing. You know, both of you said something really important, that, you know, the world is full of competing narratives. You should make sure, if you believe that your narrative is true, it should be better. It should be better expressed. It should be more factually based. It should have greater appeal. And, you know, people in the world copy best practices. I believe there's only one world culture. I'm not a cultural chauvinist. I believe humanity will go with the best practices. If you have 0 and others write Roman numbers which are unwieldy, people will go with the digital. Similarly, let good narratives come out. Let's go with facts. Let's present. And then Nand Kumarji said something very important. You know, the cowardly majority silenced by a vocal minority. Now there's a lot of research on this. There is a certain number of extremely vocal people out of 10, about 2.5, who can completely sway and bully the remaining. And there are techniques, there are toolkits, how a small, completely intransigent, intolerant minority of 2.5 can change the narrative. So please read up on some of this, more and more mind control. So I'm saying people should step out, and a little bit of courage is important. You know, we have to have some courage and not cowardice. And finally, I want to say disincentivizing divisive narratives. Divisive narratives have been incentivized, you know, through scholarships, through international collaborations, NGOs, embassies. You know, it's a big nexus. You have to disincentivize. If you keep incentivizing on one hand and then shout that you're a victim, you're not a victim. You're a culture 5,000 or more years old. You're not a victim. Why should you, you know, keep saying I'm a victim? But we have to disincentivize. Now we have some more questions. Our indomitable Professor Chahal has said, what about the recent phenomena of cultural terrorism in India, where people are trying to silence the dissent voices from Dalits and even object to the use of Dalit in academics in the name of legalism and nationalism? Please answer. He has not gone so far as to say Hindutva cultural terrorist, but whatever. You know, phenomenon of cultural terrorism where Dalit voices are silenced and there's an objection to the word Dalit. This is the question. Hari Shankarji, and then Nandakumarji. Or we can reverse the order. No problem. There's no... Sure. Now it's open. Sure. It's open. Now, go ahead.
Yeah. His question has much relevance. Because this is not the first time that we face such a question. And I have discussed this question in two chapters regarding DNA studies as well as demographic studies and the colonial studies. How the idea of caste has emerged. At least I have put forward 15 eminent scholars regarding caste in India. The caste that has emerged from the colonial British period. How they manipulated it, how new castes have emerged, and how other castes have been submerged, and a new class has emerged, who shall side with the colonials and support their ideas, support their strategies, support their agendas. So I have discussed it in two or three chapters. Most comprehensively, I have supported it, and I have given the wide reference. These are not based on studies that were taken 20 or 25 years back, but these are based on caste and sociological and anthropological studies since the last 3 or 4 years. Of course, this is a very widely discussed topic. What a eminent scholar has asked has much relevance. So I have discussed it in two or three chapters. Like what has happened, I have told about Kiyadi and other places, there are interferences. There are offering of scholarships, NGOs, they are all intervening to take up such questions, to split the society, vertical and horizontal.
Yes, sorry. Go ahead. Nandakumarji.
Okay. At that point, when the question was asked, the audio was not that clear for me. Anyway, from the answer given by Hari Shankarji, I'm assuming that the question was about how suppressing of the term used as, I mean, Dalit or something. What we can do, is it not?
Suppressing Dalit voices is a form of cultural terrorism and not using the word Dalit because of legalism and nationalism. This is the question.
I haven't got any problem. If you like some word or some term which you can express yourself as so, there is no problem as far as I am concerned. See, when you are using a term, a particular term to what you say, to express ourselves or to say a group as a particular through a particular term, like when you are using Adivasis for a particular group of people living here, of course, if you are very much fond of that word, you please use it. There is no problem about that. But you have to go deep into that term. When you are going deep into that term, then we will come to the conclusion that there is some mischief in coining such a term, some mischief of some person. When Britishers, the English people, tried to create such a term, Adivasi, then what is the meaning of Adivasi? Those who were in the beginning. And who are you calling them Adivasis? You came afterwards. They were in the beginning and you came afterwards to live with them or to invade them or attack them or annihilate them. You came afterwards or running after them. So in that term, using that term, there is a feeling and there will be a divisive mentality. Society ko baatne ka ek vichar isme andarleen hai. It has got that feeling. So those who want to unite this nation, to strengthen this nation, I feel we shall not make such division among the society. When someone is using Dalits, in what sense we are using Dalits? There are so many people being suppressed or what you say attacked, not only according to their caste. Yes, because of dumb misdeeds by some sort of people in the medieval period, and also because of the British's intervention, some particular caste group are being suppressed or sidelined or neglected by the so-called upper caste. But it all happened in later on period only. Did you call Veda Vyasa a Dalit? Can you call Vidura as a Dalit? Whether in Mahabharata or Ramayana, such people were being talked in that way? I don't think so. If you are just, what you say, saying that Vedavyasa was from a backward community, so he was a Dalit, then of course, okay, that Dalit has created all the cultural heritage, cultural wealth of ours. So that type of differentiation among the society, which was a colonial construct actually, or misdeeds by a misdirected, misunderstood group of people who misinterpreted our scriptures and all, that is why these terms came into existence. We all have to try to make all the people equal. We all have to try for that. Don't utter a word even. I would like to say, I would request you all with folded hands. Don't utter a word or term which will create a division in our society. Let us all try to unite this society. Let us all try to strengthen this great nation. That is the way in which we have to, progress. So in that way, the specific chapters, which are 3 and 4, which has been mentioned by Harishankar, he has approached this particular issue academically, very much academically, and we have to go through it. So that is what which I have to say about this particular question. And also I am repeating, if we are very much fond of saying something to express ourselves, or to say or explain some others through a particular term, I haven't any opposition, I haven't any objection. Everyone can say, and don't term it as a cultural tourism of Bharat's cultural tourism. That is not, as far as I am concerned, that's not a correct interpretation. Sorry. Namaskar.
Thank you. You know, I was some months ago called to the Ambedkar International Center, and there was a similar discussion. So I said, first of all, let us distinguish between Dr. Babasaheb Bhimrao Ambedkar himself and Ambedkarism, because once you make an ism, then many things happen. And then in Ambedkarism also, let us try to distinguish between a positive Ambedkarism and a negative Ambedkarism, you know. And let us also try as academics to understand what is the provenance of the negative Ambedkarism. Matlab wo kahan se nikla, kab se nikla, and what is its connection with Dr. Ambedkar's own writings. So I will stop at that. Here's another question which I think is very important. This is a question that has been asked by our own administrator. They say, what is the way to bring the earlier communal harmony back to Kerala, and what is the role of ruling governments in turning Kerala into a fertile land for spreading terrorism?
See, the politicization of Kerala society, that is the main problem which Kerala is facing. Sarcastically, Mananiya Parameswaranji's name has been mentioned by Professor Makaranji in the beginning itself. Parameswaranji used to say that the more the Kerala became politicized means the embryo itself, the person who is going to be born, delivery ke pahle hi politics tai ho jate hain. So through politics only they are in Kerala, our people are seeing everything. Because of that politicization of the society to that high degree, this discrimination came into existence. And also, appeasement to that extent. See, in Kerala, any sort of terrorism is being, whitewashed there in Kerala. whitewashed. See, for example, I am not talking about, or I am not trying to belittle any political party as such. See, 2 years back, one college student happened to be a prominent SFI worker, Abhimanyu. Abhimanyu was cruelly massacred, butchered by Islamic terrorist group, PF group. Do you know? We are all considering Kerala as the most cultured, most sick, most liberal and everything, blah, blah. We used to hear it everywhere. The main culprits were not booked yet. Main culprits were not booked yet, and they were supported by the so-called leftist leaders of that particular community. That much I would like to say. The same group was massacred when Nandu Krishna of RSS 4 days back. The same group. And the same political leaders who helped and saved the Abhimanyu murderers are still saving, giving shelter to this murderers, convicts, I mean, accused also. So in this way, political mileage ke liye, political gain ke liye, this type of appeasement to even to terrorism of that kind is going on there. So that is why this discrimination, differences in the society is existing. Once the all the political parties of Kerala, all the political party come out of this, appeasement policy, and also helping even terrorists, those who are not taking, importance to this society and this great nation, they should abandon, they should leave all these type of policy, then only Kerala can survive. That is the main problem which we are facing. The other day, UNO came out with a striking, shocking revelation, striking observation, UNO, United Nations Organization, they came out with an observation that the IS activities are more in Kerala and Karnataka. Many of the states of Bharat is being influenced, infected by IS activities. These are all being done under the umbrella of the political masters of Kerala, the prominent political parties. I don't want to mention any political party specifically. They are the main people who are doing all these activities. That's why this discrimination which you have mentioned, communal activities are going on in this way only, it is being supported. Marad massacre, you may be well aware, all these academicians must have been very much aware about the fact that 8 fishermen were massacred in Marad near Calicut some years back. Do you know? The major political parties were supporting those killers of PF terrorists. So once this political party came out of this mentality, and they should come after, they should accept the nationalist thinking, and then only this type of communal appeasement, communal discrimination, it will all cease to exist. Then only it will happen. That is my opinion. And also another point I would like to add is that the secessionist mentality is now growing up. It is increasing in Kerala. Some of the people are thinking that Kerala can be another nation even. Many of you may be surprised. That is why once Parameswaranji made a very clear statement that Kerala without Bharata is dangerous, and Bharat without Kerala is somewhat incomplete. Bharat ke bina Keral khatarnak hoga, Keral ke bina Bharat apurna hoga. This was one of his statement and a heading of one of his write-up. So this is the way in which these political parties are leading Kerala, and they have to become aware about these facts. I heard some sane voice during this election campaign. Some of the Congress leaders and even some communist leaders also came out with this type of statement. I feel that something will happen good after this election. I feel so. I am not sure.
Mr. Nandakumar, whatever opinion you have said, whatever you wanted to say, you said that. It's a fact. And everybody knows about that. But the question is, how can we bring change, actual change? See, whatever you said, all those philosophical things, that is there. But how all these political parties can be brought to one stage and make them convince either with love or with force? How can we convince them? Because Kerala is going in a very wrong way. And after some time, as you also, you mentioned about the UN reports saying that Kerala has become the fertile land of this ISIS. Now, if it goes on and if nobody is raising any voice and taking any action, I mean action, if no action is taken, then there will be a time where the Kerala will be left out of our control. Don't you think so?
That's why I said that the campaign going on now, I don't want to mention any particular organization's name, the organization to which I am included. I am a part of an organizational movement, intellectual movement. Already it has been mentioned, I am Pragna Pravas All India organizing or coordinator. These type of intellectual activities, campaigns are going on under the auspices of these type of organizations. And also now in Kerala during this election period, for the first time, as far as I am remembering, for the first time, both the major political fronts, now what, some of the saner elements came out, maybe they are trying for some votes from the majority community, I'm not sure, but still some sane voices are being heard now. I am seeing some sort of silver lining in that. I'm not feeling that through force only we can convert all these fellows. Love, conduct, democratic, in the democratic way of campaigning, some sort of changes will happen. I feel so, and quite hopefully, I'm as a Keralite, I'm feeling that some sort of change will happen within within few years it will happen. That's my feeling. Through campaign, through intellectual campaign, democratic exercises, only we can change the attitude of the population.
Thank you. Thank you. Any other questions? This has been very lively, and many, many issues have come out. And we have been, I should say, very candid, which I consider to be a healthy sign. We have expressed ourselves as people who care about both the ideas as well as about the nation we live in. And I think that is very healthy. So if I still ask if anybody here wishes to raise any question, please do so now. Even if you have a contrary view, we welcome it, no problem. Or if you want to challenge some of these opinions also, you're free to do so. Please go ahead.
Yes.
If not, once again, I'm very honored to, host this book discussion. I congratulate Dr. B.S. Harishankar for this splendid work. I'm very grateful indeed to Nandakumarji. Thank you, sir. And I hope you can visit us sometime soon. We would like to hear more from you. And I'm also very grateful to our fellows, to our academic resources officer, Ritika Ji, to our system analysts, to our librarian, to everyone who made this program possible. And we have recorded it and we will put it on YouTube or Facebook Live. I'm sure it will have hundreds, if not thousands of views very soon. Thank you all so much. Have a good Namaskar. Evening.
Thank
Namaskar.
You.
Namaskar, sir.
Namaste.
Namaste.
Namaste. Namaste.
Namaste. Namaste.